Next up, we have Jack Weeks, and Jack is going to talk to us about implementing hydraulic root cause failure analysis to eliminate the problem. I know I'm super interested in that. So just a little bit about Jack. He entered GPM's organization in January 1997 as a CAD draftsman and a hydraulic instructor. Jack has trained thousands of electricians and mechanics in hydraulic troubleshooting methods. He regularly speaks at conferences and symposia like this. His computerized animations have made GPM's presentations and online basic hydraulic troubleshooting training the recognized leader in the industry. He received his education from Georgia Institute of Technology, School of Electrical Engineering, and the Department of State Foreign Services Institute. He taught radio wave propagation for the U.S. Air Force and telecommunications equipment operation and repair for the CIA at American embassies overseas. All right, so join me in welcoming Jack Weeks. Thank you, Jack.
Thank you very much. Let's see, where was the clicker thing?
David, is the clicker on the podium?
Is it up here on the podium here?
Is it clicker? David, don't be making off with the clicker. Is it on the podium there? That's it.
Okay.
All right. I'm sorry, David. You're off the hook.
I need my PowerPoint on here, though. While we're doing that, I also have a printed version here to hand out. Might make it a little bit easier to follow.
Oh, that's nice.
Thank you.
Out here, and here's, I got more than I need, so. Pass those around there. And I brought a few gifts for everybody as well. Help yourself to these. Please don't make me take these back to Atlanta. Take two or three. We've got, if you have any hydraulics in your facility at all, you've got some technicians that want one of these. It's a little chart that has all of the hydraulic symbols on it.
That's cool.
And everybody had to travel here. You all need a travel mug or three. So, like I said, I've got more than I need here. Please don't make me take any more back with me. Very proud to be asked to speak here. Jordan has been a great conference so far. I've really enjoyed it, and I know a lot of other people have told me the same thing. I got to say, your feet is pretty good. I've been taking pictures so I can show my doctor how healthy I've been eating here the last week. That he's not the best troubleshooter in the world, so I like to. I used to not go to doctors at all. You know, we'd, when I first started working with GPM, we would schedule all of our training and our consulting visits based on people's kids' soccer games and what plays they were in and all that kind of thing. Now, we schedule them on everybody's doctor visits, right? I never used to go to the doctor at all, but it's a very common thing anymore. And like I said, they're not very good troubleshooters. I remember several years ago we changed insurance carriers, and those of us over 40 all had to get a physical. That was the first time I'd been to a doctor in many years. And the guy says, "Well, who's your regular doctor?" And I said, "Well, I guess you are." And he said, "Well, when's the last time you went to a doctor?" I said, "I don't remember." I do remember that I could smoke in the waiting room last time I went to visit the doctor. So, but they hadn't got any better. I mean, I'm sitting there in all my glory and in my underwear, and he comes walking in looking at his clipboard, and he says, "You know, you're overweight." That can't be true. And he says, "Yeah, you're overweight. Have you lost or gained a lot of weight here recently?" And I said, no, I'm one of them lucky guys. I eat whatever I want to. I can stay right at 286 pounds. And he said, "Well, what's the least you ever weighed?" I said, 7 pounds, 9 ounces. So, What we do is help people be better troubleshooters. I've traveled all over the country and outside of it for many years, and I've met literally thousands of people who at least part of their job is to deal with fluid power. I've met a lot of very excellent people who work on fluid power systems. The number of fluid power troubleshooters I have met, now that I can count those on the fingers of one hand, what I have met have been a lot of very excellent fluid power parts changers. Okay? Do you have any of those at your plants there, guys that have been around a machine for so long, they've seen it fail in so many different ways that they know that when the machine is doing this over here, if I change this part right here, it starts working again, okay? I'm not denigrating that. Somebody with that kind of experience, that's a valuable person to have working for you. But it's not troubleshooting, it's parts changing, and it works great as long as changing the part does in fact fix the problem. The trouble comes when our parts changer changes his part and it doesn't fix the problem. You ever seen that happen? Have exactly the same thing going on with the machine you had 6 months ago. You changed the same part that fixed it 6 months ago, but it doesn't fix the problem. What's the next thing that a parts changer does? Anybody? Change something else, that's right. Yeah, is it going to put the old part back on that didn't fix it? Of course not. That was about to go anyway, right? And so we continue to change parts until one of two things happen. Until either we've got the system back working like it's supposed to be, or we put it in such a state we have to call somebody. And of course, you can call us. And it's, admittedly, it's not cheap. I mean, our time is valuable and there's travel costs and everything, but it's probably cheaper than not calling because, well, what is the most expensive part of a fluid power failure? Is it the part that it took to fix it? No, the downtime, right? And that can run into some real cash. That is what we focus on. In our opinion, there are five things that someone needs to know to be a fluid power troubleshooter. The first thing he needs to know is the function of every component in the system. He needs to know what everything does, because if there's even one component that they don't know what it does, they have no idea if that could be the problem or not, right? The second thing that they need to know is how to read and use a hydraulic schematic as a troubleshooting tool. That chart ought to help any of your technicians who deal with it sometimes. You know, it's not something you deal with all the time, and very few places have many guys that their specialty is hydraulics. That's something they do too, right? So a lot of people like to have something like that hanging up because they need to use a schematic to troubleshoot the system. If you ever call me, come help you with a problem. I want to know two things. I want to know where's the coffee pot, and I want to know where are the schematics, because that's the first thing we're going to do. We're going to trace the flow in the system on the schematic to identify the components that could be causing the problem and eliminate those that could not be causing the problem. Then and only then do we go to troubleshoot individual components, preferably without removing them from the system. We don't want to take anything off of the machine until we have very good reason to believe that it is bad. Airborne contaminants that are much too small to see can wreak havoc with these systems. So troubleshooting by a component, individual components, is very important. The fourth thing that he needs to know, how to properly adjust the system, okay? And a lot of people will take issue with me on that one and say, well, Jack, I'm sure adjusting is important, but adjusting and troubleshooting, those aren't really the same thing. Well, maybe, I don't know. I know if I go to visit a plant and it turns out we don't have to change anything, we just have to adjust something, you know, we don't give a discount for that. The bill's going to be the same regardless there. And you might be surprised just how many times I have had to drive for several hours or even fly across the country to do nothing more than tell someone to make an adjustment. The fifth and final thing that a troubleshooter needs to know is the correct reliability checks to make in the system. Just a few minutes a month, I can spot symptoms. Everything has a symptom before it fails. And I've heard here in this conference a number of places where I wish more people did have some IoT devices that were consistently monitoring, in some cases flow, in a few cases pressure, in a lot of cases temperature. If I had something I could go back to like that, that would be a valuable tool for me. And I could diagnose the problem a lot faster. But sometimes we troubleshoot the system and we find the exact same problem that and the exact same component causing the problem that we've seen two or three times before. That's where the root cause failure analysis comes in. And that's kind of what we want to talk about today. Now, I learned about root cause failure analysis from a really smart guy. I've heard of a number of authors and mentors that some of you have. Have any of you ever heard of a fellow by the name of Heinz Block? He's a German guy. He spent his career with ExxonMobil, and I met him originally speaking at the ExxonMobil symposium. And then at several others afterward, I had the privilege of speaking alongside Heinz, and I couldn't exactly call him a mentor, but I have learned an awful lot from him. And he was the first to explain to me the basics of root cause failure analysis. He's a really smart guy. He's in his 80s, still going strong. He's the closest that I know of a troubleshooter who's like a rock star. I mean, he's known globally and for all different types of troubleshooting. I'd love to be like Heinz when I grow up, but he's quite a guy. And the methods that he has shown me, these two little hashtags, I've seen these an awful lot, and they kind of represent what I understand root cause failure analysis to be. 5 why and 5 how. Well, I got a nephew named Rob. He's about 7 years old, and his favorite word is why. Okay, and for years, I've listened to him ask me why for just about anything. And I kind of encourage it and I indulge it because he's a nephew and he's not my kid, right? I only have to deal with him every now and again. Now, his parents, they get tired of it, and they say, ask Uncle Jack. If he doesn't know, he'll make something up, right? But they always why. And you answer his questions, oh, well, why is that? And why? If he keeps that up, he's going to be great at root cause failure analysis, because that's the whole idea here. We keep asking why until the root cause is determined. Okay. Then the 5 how. Once we've determined the root cause, then we keep asking how until we get to the solution that resolves the problem. And that's, to me, part and parcel of root cause failure analysis. And on occasion, you know, most of the time, when I go to a plant and help solve a problem, we find the component and the machine's back running, everybody's happy. I don't like to leave it at that. We always write up a consulting report, and We dig a little bit deeper to try to figure out why that component failed. You know, if you have a valve, for instance, it's failing, if you're changing it two or three times a month, it's not the valve that's the problem, right? It's something's making it fail. Now, I've been to plenty of plants where they could be changing the same valve two or three times a month and not even be aware of it. I can find a maintenance superintendent who can tell me how many of these valves he's bought in the last year, but he usually can't tell me which machines they went on. They could be going to the exact same place, and they bought 40 of them in the last year, and you know, a guy on the one shift changes it, and nobody ever hears about it. Most of the time, when I go to a plant to help diagnose a problem, I got to ask a lot of questions. I got to do some detective work to determine what has already been done to the machine. I can ask five different people and get six different answers of everything that's been done. There's usually not any one person who knows everything that was done to a problem, because by the time I get called, a lot of parts changing has gone on. And maybe what started out as something relatively simple is now multiple issues and very tough to diagnose. And that's why they call me. So we have to do some digging. We have to understand what's already been done. We have to get to the root cause in a lot of cases. It's like a ladder. I've been watching everybody with these laser pointers. These TV things, these are great. You don't have, no longer do you have to turn the lights down slow. Everybody's falling asleep, but you got a nice bright picture, but no matter what you got, it's not gonna show up on, the laser's not gonna show up on there. So I decided I'd go old school here, and we'll. There we go. Now see, there's not anything they can build that's gonna keep this from working, right? So it's like a ladder. You go down the ladder to find why, and then you go back up the ladder figuring out how to resolve the issue, right? See, I learned this the hard way, because everywhere I go anymore, they've got these things, and my red laser pointer didn't work, and the guy says, well, yeah, you got to get a green laser pointer for that to work. And so I bought everybody a $50 green laser pointer and pointed at the first one, and no, it don't work either, right? So. There needs to be, I guess, so I could just push a button and it just. So I still got to have the manual stick, but this works. It's not going to have any power failures or anything like that. All right, now I know everybody's probably seen the tree. Hines showed me the tree, and I thought I'd share this with you, and it's in the book there. But first thing, we have an event, and the event keeps happening, and we'd like that to stop. So first, we form a team, okay? Now, that team, we'll talk about that a little bit, but the best people to try to figure out where the root cause might be. Then we define the problem. We want that. We want to be able to say it in a few words. Little sticky notes there. If we can write it down on that little sticky note, that's a good thing. Okay? If it's too complex, that tells me you don't really understand the problem. Collecting data. Now, like I said, there's a lot of places where it'd be nice if people had these automatic data collection things. They'd be great. I honestly don't run into them very much. I hope shows like this are going to promote their use a little bit. That'll certainly make my job a lot easier. This is the collection stage here. All right, now we determine the causes. I mean all the causes that could possibly be. Do a little brainstorming here. What's the immediate cause? All right. Contributing cause and the root cause, might be more than one. That's the analysis phase. All right, now we're going to start back up the ladder for a solution here. We're going to determine a preventive action that can stop this from happening again, and then test and implement and see if that works. That's our solution phase. So it's, you know, if you have it all in one little tree like that, it helps a lot. Now you start filling these things in, expanding the tree, it can get kind of complicated. But for a basis, it's a good way to start. The collection phase, form a team. Now that team, that's going to be we want natural team members, people who have ownership of the machine. Then we start to add influence. All right, a lot of times that's where I get called, is to add some outside influence. Maybe I've seen this kind of thing before, and then we start to define the problem. And like I said, it needs to be short, simple, easy to understand. We can't have something really complex that doesn't make any sense. That's not going to work. It has to be easy to understand, or or we don't really have the problem defined properly. This is a big one right here. An awful lot of places I go, they already know what it is. I don't even know why they called you. The reason is because of this, right? Well, sometimes it is, sometimes it isn't. But what we need to begin, at least, with no bias. And a lot of times people get kind of frustrated with me because I'll say, well, I want to try this here. So I've already done that. This is what's going to happen. And well, yeah, maybe. But I kind of need to see it for myself because I've been burned too many times. Somebody saying, well, I've already changed it, I've already corrected that, that's already been done. Well, turns out that was where the problem was all along, and I've been there for several hours. It makes me look pretty stupid, right? So I have to hurt people's feelings sometimes and have to get past some biases. All right, now the collection of data, that's a bigger deal than it sounds like. That could be physical evidence, and people love to clean things up. And when you call the consultant out, you don't want him to see what a mess you've made. You know, my first wife, we had a maid, and she'd always clean the house before the maid got there because she didn't want the maid to know, you know, what kind of pigsty we actually lived in, you know. And I said, we're paying her to clean the place. Well, you know, don't try to impress your consultant by how nice you keep everything. Keep it the way it was so he has something to go by. Our recorded evidence is usually precious little of that. Now, I'm sure that a lot of the electrical machinery in there, a lot of the mechanical components, maybe they are doing some of that. I'm not seeing much of it at all in hydraulics. So a lot of what we've talked about these last few days, I can see some big places where we need some recorded evidence. Most places I go, they got all kind of records. Nothing that's going to help us identify a hydraulic problem. Which brings us to personal testimony, and I just talked about that, didn't I? Personal testimony, any cop will tell you that when he gets into court, the eyewitness testimony is not very reliable, and it's not any better in a plant, believe me. All right, our analysis phase, determine the causes, follow the data, to consider both technical and organizational causes. A lot of stuff doesn't break by itself. Sometimes people break it, and sometimes our practices are the problem. Concentrate on analysis. Don't worry about problem solving just yet. Concentrate on analysis. We're going to be spending plenty of time solving the problem. and resist the temptation to lay the blame on the operator or maintenance. Yeah, yeah, the operators, sometimes they do abuse the machine. I don't see that as really our biggest issue, but that's usually the first thing everybody goes to is, yeah, we got these guys here, they don't care about it. In fact, they hope it goes down so they can get a break. That's not really what I see. What I see is people that have a job and they're glad to have one and they want to do whatever they can do to keep one. Okay? All right, and maintenance, well, of course it's maintenance's fault, right? That's they're the ones who are supposed to keep it running and it's not running. So it's real easy to blame maintenance, but that's not always the problem either. In fact, it's not even usually the problem. Okay, look at our immediate and our root and our contributing causes. We only have this phase complete when all of these have been identified. And the root cause is also dependent on the reach of the team. Sometimes it's beyond the reach of the team. And I'm going to talk about one of those here in just a minute with a little short case study. The solution, determine a corrective and preventive action. Any of my reports, I always make recommendations at the end of how we can keep this from happening again. Sometimes they follow it, sometimes they don't. And that's probably why I still have a job, because so many people don't. And so keep on doing that, if you would, please. I'd like to still have something to do for a living. Test and implement. If that's not what we need, let's find what we do need so that it doesn't keep happening. Okay. All right, now the good news, I guess. I guess it's good news. This little pie chart of our most common hydraulic failure root causes. Now, does it look a little unbalanced to you? I am told, and my own personal experience kind of bears this out, that over 90%, in some cases I've read 95%, of hydraulic failures can be directly attributed to improper care of the fluid. Now, that's a pretty strong number right there, but I've got to say, this chart, this little pie chart here, pretty well reflects what I've seen over my career. It's a pretty rare hydraulic component I've ever seen removed that I could not attribute its failure to improper care of the fluid. Now, I'm not saying that people don't have a fluid maintenance program in place. Everyone has some sort of fluid maintenance program in place. Some people do a better job than others, but I'm in a lot of plants. I've long since lost count of how many plants, but I've never been to even one plant that had no room for improvement over how they take care of their hydraulic fluid. And I know a lot of folks have some special considerations. Maybe you have fire hazards. Maybe you're on the West Coast over there where they're really conscious about environmental impact should you spring a leak. Okay? Maybe we have some food processing people. They have to use an edible hydraulic oil. Some places have to use a water glycol emulsion, and you got some special challenges with that. But even with standard petroleum-based hydraulic oil, you have to take care of it. If you take care of it, it'll last very nearly forever. And so will the machine. And some of the others that could be incorrect pressures. Like I said, I've been to hundreds of plants, and I have no idea how many I've been to, but I can tell you exactly how many plants I've visited had all their pressures set correctly. If I come to your plant and we find all of your pressures set correctly, that'll make one so far. What do I usually find? Do you suppose I mostly find pressure set too high or too low? Or is it just a toss-up? Too high, yeah. Yeah, too high. What do you suppose the driving force is there? What are they trying to accomplish in most cases, do you think? Make it run faster, yeah. Okay. I'm not going to give you a hydraulics course here or anything, but pressure and speed have absolutely nothing to do with each other. Speed is determined by the rate of hydraulic flow. The only time turning up the pressure will, in fact, speed up the system is when turning up the pressure also increases the flow. If turning up the pressure also increases the flow, then what that really is telling you is that there was a better way, a more efficient way that you could have sped it up. Okay? So, that's the first thing. What's the best pressure? The best pressure is the lowest pressure that gets the job done. A bad installation. Okay, now that I've run across that a few times. In particular, leaks. But now I know none of you have any leaks in any of your systems, right? But, most leaks are caused by a bad installation. And I'm sure you've seen me hobbling around here on a cane. That's as a result of a leak. About 20 years ago, I guess, I slipped on some hydraulic fluid and I did a split like cheerleaders do. Right? It wasn't near as pretty as when they do it, but and it hurt for quite a while, and it got better, and I was fine for years, and then it came back in the form of arthritis, and I had to have a hip replacement, and it's been a nightmare. Leaks cost a lot of money. Were I of a litigious nature, that one could have cost somebody an awful lot of money. But most people measure the cost of leaks by how much they're spending in oil. If you're interested what a leak really costs, I did write a blog on the subject. Go to our website and look it up. But the cost of the oil is not even the highest factor. So that's usually the result from bad installations. Bad design. Now, we did have in one case at an OSB mill in Florida. We found they were changing a pump on a pretty regular basis on one of their finishing machines. And as a result of root cause failure analysis, we were able to determine that that particular pump had a lubricating port that was too small. Had we not performed the root cause failure analysis and had the records to prove it, that would have been the end of it. We'd have to just buy another kind of pump. As it turned out, they actually got some remuneration from the manufacturer. And, that had a good ending to the story. Other causes, that's just about anything. Human foibles there and bad practices and that type of thing. But the big one is taking care of your fluid. If you'll take proper care of your fluid, then most of your hydraulic problems just go away. Now, here's an example. We were talking about one that was out of the reach of the team. This one was kind of out of reach of the team. There's a company in Georgia that makes these plastic totes that you put chemicals and just anything in, these 300-gallon totes. I'm sure you've seen those. And they had a number of components that were having to be changed on a very regular basis, and they really couldn't figure out why that was. So they called us, and when I got there, they showed me some of the ones they were having the biggest problems with. And I said, well, let's take them apart. Let's see what we can find. And we found them filled with corrosion. Hydraulic components, you know, you might find trash in there, but you really should never find any corrosion unless you've got water in your oil. And so we took a sample. And that's this right here is what it looked like. Clearly, it's full of water. And we got one of our flushing machines over there, flushed the system out and got it nice and clear and everything. But they changed the oil in a machine next to it. And I just happened to see they you gotta get a sample of the oil you're using there. Well, this is what was going in, coming from the oil vendor. This actually has more water in it than this does. The oil was getting better because of the heat from the machine. The water was evaporating to some degree. But what was going in was wetter than what we found. Now, this is kind of out of the reach of the team, right? There's not much you can do about that except get with your oil vendor, and that was what we did. We kind of brought him onto the team to make it clear that we're either going to have to get another oil vendor or we're going to have to do something about this. Now, that's unacceptable. I wonder how many of his other customers were just dealing with it and thinking that they had something wrong with their machines. But that's what it turned out to be. All right, everybody's favorite component to replace is the pump. That's the first thing everybody goes to. No matter what's wrong with the machine, first thing everybody wants to change is the pump. That doesn't fix it, we'll try something else, but first let's change the pump. I can't tell you how many calls I have had over the years that start out, well, Jack, I got this pressure problem on my machine, and we changed the pump, but it didn't fix it. You got any other ideas for what it might be? The pump should never be the first thing to change, particularly for a pressure problem. If it's a pressure problem, the pump really ought to be your last resort. It's extremely unlikely for a system to have a pressure problem and that be the pump causing the pressure problem. And if you understand how the pump works, you'll see why that is, right? But in order for there to be a pressure problem, the pump has to not be delivering almost anything at all. And that if it doesn't sound like a bucket of bolts, and it's not shooting oil out of the shaft seal, then it's probably not the pump causing a pressure problem. So just a very brief overview of how a pump is put together here. This is a pressure compensating piston pump. By that I mean that the pump delivers exactly the amount of fluid that the system needs, right? It senses that based on the pressure. Now, this is a shaft here. The shaft turns a barrel. The barrel has pistons mounted in there, kind of like bullets in a revolver. And they're physically connected to this cam right here, which we call a swash plate. Okay? And the angle of the swash plate determines how far each of the pistons can stroke, and therefore the delivery of the pump, the amount of flow that's delivered there. Okay? So, As the shaft is turning, you see that the pistons down here are stroking out, pistons up here are stroking in, oil comes in this way, comes out this way. The swash plate is held at its maximum angle by this spring right here. Okay? So at this point, we're delivering the maximum flow that it can deliver. Anything that bypasses across the really tight clearances between the piston and the barrel, that goes into the pump case and goes out the case drain, right? As that pump wears, what do you suppose happens to the flow here? It will increase, won't it? Because the clearances are going to increase. This right here would be a great place for one of them IoT devices there to monitor the flow. I usually recommend people install a flow meter and once a month walk around out there and write down what it says. But, man, one of those things there. If we had something put into a database somewhere, what the case flow has been over the last 6 months, man, that tells me real quick what kind of trend we have on that pump. So if you're looking for somewhere to put something, that's a real good place to put something. Okay? But now, the machine doesn't always need all the flow that the pump can deliver. It goes by the pressure. You see, I've got a pressure gauge over here. It's reading 800 PSI, but this is 1200 PSI over here. This is called the compensator valve. And there's that symbol on the bottom here, that kind of a squiggly line, that's a spring. And you might can see it a little better in the handout than you can here, but you'll see that the spring has a diagonal arrow drawn through it. A diagonal arrow on any hydraulic component means that it's variable in some fashion or adjustable, right? More often than not, it means that that component has a knob on it, right? Something for the knob turner to get his mitts on. Everybody got one of them, right? The knob turner? His name is not me. Who messed with the knob over there? Not me. Well, the last time that not me got hold of this knob, he set it at 1200 PSI. So this pump's going to go full force, going to deliver everything it's got until the pressure gets up to 1200 PSI, at which point the valve is going to shift and reduce the flow until it holds that pressure at 1200 PSI. Okay? Now, if we start something else moving, that's going to demand more flow than the pump is delivering, so it's going to have to stroke some more and add flow. If we stop something in the system, we're not using all the flow. Pressure's going to go up, so it'll de-stroke and reduce its flow. And if we idle everything, we stop all the stuff from moving, it goes into an idle condition and completely reduces its flow to zero, but maintains the compensator setting in the line. Well, that now it's ready to go to work whenever we need it. Let me ask you a question. What do you suppose will happen if this valve right here sticks like that? That valve sticks in that condition where it's keeping pressure on this little cylinder, you're not going to get anything out of the pump, are you? Right? Well, you see, that's why people change these pumps, because they have a pressure problem, because as soon as we demand flow, the pressure is going to drop, isn't it? You change the pump. Well, the new pump has a compensator valve that's not stuck, doesn't it? You fix the problem. Everybody's patting you on the back, right? You still screwed up, just don't nobody know it, right? Well, one guy knows it. Whoever it is that rebuilds your pumps, he knows it. And, of course, he's going to call you up and tell you, hey, you didn't have a bad pump. It didn't need to be rebuilt. Just had a little trash in your compensator valve. I'm going to clean it out for you and send it back to you at no charge. Yeah, right. Now, what you're going to get is a $4,000 paint job on your pump, right? I would estimate at least, probably more, but at least 50% of the pumps that I have seen changed over the years were changed because that valve right there was stuck. So at the very least, before somebody ever changes a pump, that valve was on, there were four little Allen screws. You pull it off, it has a little small orifice just about big enough to get a gem clip, straighten it out and stick in there. If that little orifice is plugged up, grain of sand, anything that could plug that orifice up, this is what's going to happen. But if it's a pressure problem, it's probably not the pump. Now, one very common problem, cavitation, and well, it's actually two problems, but cavitation and aeration. They sound a lot alike, and a lot of people get them confused. A lot of people hear a pump cavitate, and they think that that's a symptom that the pump is bad. It's a steady, high-pitched whining sound, and changing the pump quite often will fix it, not because it was the pump was bad, but because the act of changing the pump will quite often take care of whatever was causing the problem, right? Now, the difference between the two, cavitation, that's the formation and collapse of air cavities in the liquid. That is, hydraulic oil has a very small amount of air entrained in it. The engineers call it dissolved air. Well, it's not a chemical bond, so it's not really dissolved. But if anything keeps that pump from getting as much fluid into it as it's trying to deliver, that's what will make it cavitate. All right. The suction pressure drops very, very low, and it pulls the air cavities out of the oil, and it travels over to the pressure side of the pump where it implodes. That's what's making the sound. Anything that will inhibit the suction, most common being the suction strainer. Steady, high-pitched whine. Now, aeration, that's the result of outside air getting in the suction line, right? It's a much more erratic sound, and it will usually be accompanied by a sound similar to marbles or gravel rattling around inside the pump. On an electron microscope, this is what it looks like. It pulls the air cavity into the pump, and it goes across to the pressure side and implodes. Now, if a pump is strong enough to do that, probably strong enough to keep doing its job. You hear a steady, high-pitched whining sound or a more erratic sound with marbles or gravel rattling around in there. Find what's causing it. You know, if it's the suction strainer, clean the suction strainer out. If it's aeration, a lot of times that's caused by loose fitting. It might be caused by a leak in the suction line. You know, the suction line pressure and the suction line is below atmospheric pressure, so fluid's not going to leak out. Air's going to leak in. Get some oil in the oil can, squirt it up and down, see if it stops doing it. If it stops doing it for a second, then you found your leak. Or sometimes a bad shaft seal, you draw air in with it. If you think you might have a bad shaft seal, get you some shaving cream, put it around the shaft seal. And if it is getting air in, it's going to pull shaving cream in. You see holes in there where it pulls shaving cream into it, kind of like pee holes in the snow. If it does that, then you know you've got a bad shaft seal. Replace your shaft seal instead of having to replace the whole pump. All right. Here's an example here of a pump that was destroyed by cavitation. This happened at an OSB mill in Georgia. They went through about four pumps in 1 week. Obviously, we had a situation that required some root cause failure analysis, wouldn't you agree? And we followed the steps, and they were thinking that they were getting a bad pump, that this was some kind of design problem. Somebody, the guy that rebuilt the pump, maybe he just wasn't doing his job. I happened to be there when it started cavitating, though, and I immediately recognized the sound. I said, no, this pump's being destroyed. The pump isn't bad. It's just being made bad by something here. And then it stopped. It started running fine again. That's something I'd never seen before. I said, wait a minute here. You know, if something's plugging it up, it's going to keep on plugging it up, right? And we opened up the reservoir. And what we found was the suction strainer had come loose and was floating around in the oil. And it would get over there to the suction side and jam up in there. And the pump started cavitating. And then as soon as something changed, And the suction pressure increased a little bit, it would float back away again, and everything's working fine. Okay. And the root cause there, well, if you have suction strainers on your pumps, it needs to be somebody's job to periodically inspect and clean these things. Right? If it's not going to be somebody's job to inspect and clean these things, we recommend you take them out of there. Yeah, they'll keep the big pieces from getting into the pump all right, but the pump can stand a few big pieces here and there a whole lot better than it can withstand blocking up the suction line. It takes just minutes to destroy a pump, sometimes seconds to destroy a pump if you're operating at high enough pressure when it cavitates like that. And this is what it looked like. Look at the pistons here. See, they go through the hole there, and they were broken off and just all in pieces. The swash plate itself had a ring cut into it. It was supposed to be perfectly smooth. It had this ring cut into it. And this is after hours of service, not years. So very quickly this will happen. Okay. This pump here is a result of aeration. You see the seal there, how that's all torn up. And just on one side, see, this side over here is nice and smooth, but over here we've got these pits all in there. And that's where outside air was brought over to the pressure side and imploded. Okay. In this particular case, this was at a paper mill in Virginia. This is a machine that they call a guillotine. And it's about what it sounds like, the blade that cuts paper down the center there, and they'd bring it down. It's a very simple machine, and it was quite often ignored. What had actually happened here, they'd allowed it to run out of oil, and what oil was in there was badly contaminated. It was poor practices. But once we got it flushed and clean oil and keeping it clean, our problem went away. But they went through several pumps before this was resolved, and it was simply a matter of just not taking care of the oil. Okay, well, I've been here enough here, I believe. Any questions on any of this here? No, anybody? Yes, sir, there's an issue.
The quality of oil, and is it time based, or is it, you know, so many often you should be changing the hydraulic fluid, or is it contamination, or, you know, checking something?
Historically, the way we do it is we take quarterly samples and send them off and have them analyzed, and somebody who can read an oil analysis can tell, just like a doctor can tell stuff by the fluids that come out of you. Somebody that can read an oil analysis can tell an awful lot about a hydraulic machine from the analysis of the fluid. But an actual fact, for simple things like a particle count, there's laser particle counters that you can put in the line that tell you exactly what kind of particulate matter is going into your components. So you could do it yourself, or you could have it done. But it's irresponsible not to do it at all.
Okay, thank you.
Any others? Well, it's been a pleasure. Thank you very much. Please do come up here and get some of my goodies. Don't make me take these back to Atlanta. Take two or three so I don't have to carry them back, but thank you very much.
Yeah. Thank you, Jack. That was not only incredibly informative, but also very entertaining. Thank you.
Thank you.